Good morning, friends here at Farringdon, and you watching from home. Welcome to our worship service for March the 12th. Start of March break, so the kids are happy, teachers are happy, and this place is going to be full this week with activity as kids off of school come here to learn about God and to have fun together. So we're looking forward to this week. And apparently you got the memo to set your clocks ahead an hour. You're here. Welcome. Our opening scripture is from Psalm 103, verse 13. The Lord is like a father to his children, tender and compassionate to all who trust him. So as we listen to the prelude, just call out to your Father now. Tell him what's on your heart, what you're thankful for, and also what you need. We'll do that in silence. If you're able, when the chimes sound, please stand with your bulletin. The Lord of hosts is with you. This is from Psalm 121. We lift up our eyes for help. No, our help comes from the Lord. He will not let our feet slip. The Lord watches over us. The Lord will keep us from all harm. The Lord watches over his people, both now and forever. That's what this next hymn talks about, God of the Ages. And that's 78 in the hymnal, verses 1 to 3. God of the ages, history's maker, planning our pathway, holding us fast, shaping in mercy all that concerns us. Father, we praise you, Lord of the God of this morning, gladly your children worship before you, trustingly bow. Teach us to know you, always among us, Father, we pray, reverend, Lord of our After you turn and wave at a neighbor, then you can find your seat. And we say again, hi at home. We're glad each of you could be here today. Please be seated. Caitlin, not you. Come on up.
Good morning, everyone. Well, the week is here. VBS is happening this week. And I am excited that it's the day after the time change. So please pray extra for us tomorrow, because kids are always really happy the day after the time change. But I'm glad they're going to be here with me. We're going to have a great week, Monday to Thursday, 1 o'clock until 4 o'clock. But I still need two crew leaders for Thursday. So if anybody wants to hang out and rotate around stations with kids, or, you know, a teenager who's not doing anything, Thursday, 1 o'clock till 4 o'clock, that would be amazing to get two extra enthusiastic helpers that day. Also, I've been asked by the Vision Committee to announce that there's a sign-up sheet in the Narthex for the next ladies' lunch on March 29th at 11:30 at the Windmill. Also, we're still collecting loose change for Yvette, our sponsor child. And finally, in November, we collected shoe boxes for Operation Christmas Child. I received some information in my email this week about where our boxes went, how many boxes got sent from Canada. I'd encourage you, if you participated in that, there's a bunch of info about that in the bulletin. Also, just a reminder for parents who are dropping kids off for VBS, that we're going to be dropping off at the office entrance here at 1 o'clock, and to drop kids off in their snowsuits or whatever they wear to be outside, because our first half an hour of program is going to be outside. And I think that's all from me.
We are celebrating communion because it's the second Sunday of the month, and so we use these little cups. You should have gotten one in the narthex on the way in. And if you didn't and want to participate, anytime in the next 30 minutes, just go out and get your cup to have it with you. We say happy birthday to Waverly Butler at home. We missed you on the 3rd. We didn't get it in the bulletin, so we're fixing that today, Waverly. The 12th today is Dan Hines' birthday. God bless you, Dan. Tomorrow, Greg Holyomes on the 13th. Day after the 14th is Lisa Meyerink's birthday. And then next Sunday, the 19th, David Dean. Hazel Fallis has moved out of the Willett Hospital into Seasons Retirement Home, and her new address and phone is listed there. She's had a few very low days after just moving in there, and so pray for Hazel that God gives her strength. Now, this full-page announcement I'm looking forward to, called Women in the Bible. It's a Bible study for men and women, but we're looking at some of the key women who followed God and what they can teach us. Now, that's not this Tuesday. It's a week from Tuesday, so the 21st at 10:30 a.m. in the conference room. All right, that covers our announcements. We're going to turn our attention to God's Word, 1 Daniel chapter 6.
All right, so our first lesson is from the book of Daniel, chapter 6, verses 16 to 23. Then the king gave the order for Daniel to be brought and thrown into the lion pit. But he said to Daniel, "Your God, whom you serve at all times, may he save you." A stone was brought and put over the mouth of the pit, and the king sealed it with his signet and with the signets of his nobles, so that no attempt could be made to rescue Daniel. The king went to his palace and spent the night fasting. No woman was brought to him, and sleep eluded him. He was greatly agitated, and at the first light of dawn, he rose and went to the lion pit. When he came near, he called anxiously, "Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to save you from the lions?" Daniel answered, "Long live the king. My God sent his angel to shut the lions' mouths, and they have not injured me. He judged me innocent, and moreover, I had done your majesty no injury." The king was overjoyed and gave orders that Daniel should be taken up out of the pit. When this was done, no trace of injury was found on him, because he had put his faith in his God. The word of the Lord.
The New Testament, it's Hebrews 10, starting at verse 19.
The second lesson is Hebrews 10, verse 19 to 25, found on page 201. So now, my friends, the blood of Jesus makes us free to enter the sanctuary with confidence by the new and living way which he has opened for us through the curtain, the way of his flesh. We have a great priest set over the household of God, so let us make our approach in sincerity of heart and the full assurance of faith, inwardly cleansed from a guilty conscience and outwardly washed with pure water. Let us be firm and unswerving in the confession of our hope, for the giver of the promise is to be trusted. We ought to see how each of us may best arouse others to love and act of goodness. We should not stay away from our meetings, as some do, but rather encourage one another, all the more because we see the day of the Lord drawing near. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 19 to 24. Page 5 in the New Testament. Jesus tells us, "Do not store up for yourselves treasure on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and thieves break in and steal. But store up treasure in heaven, where neither moth nor rust will destroy, nor thieves break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." The lamp of the body is the eye. If your eyes are sound, you will have light for your whole body. But if your eyes are bad, your whole body will be in darkness. If then the only light you have is darkness, how great a darkness that will be. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the first and love the second, or he will be devoted to the first and despise the second. So you cannot serve both God and money. The Gospel of Christ. Just before we pray out loud the Lord's Prayer, I encourage you just to turn to that blue box in our bulletin where we have listed some of our members, not all. But condolences and prayers, we pray for our members, Michelle Carter, B. Cranston, both at home, Tom Young and John Noble home. As I said before, please add Hazel Fallis, as she's struggling this week, and you know of others in our church family. Let's intercede for them. Just say, "God bless, God heal." And then we'll pray the Lord's Prayer together when I cue us. Father, have mercy on your people and answer us now as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. 523 in the hymnal is "Soon and Very Soon." We'll sing verses 1 and 2. And kids, you join Caitlin up here for verse 2. You walk forward, okay?
All right, so.
Hi.
How's it going?
Good.
Today's question is, do you collect anything? What do you collect, Maya? Markers. That's a great thing to collect. Do any adults collect anything? Annette, what do you collect? Mickey Mouse. Anybody back here collect? Judy, what do you collect? Christmas ornaments. Books? Nice. Money. All right. Well, I brought a few pictures from my picture collection. So I thought you guys could take a quick look at them. See if they're, if you're in any of them. Who's that? That's a little baby. That's my niece, yeah. So, these pictures that I've collected, are they worth much money? They're worth much money? Really? Would you buy that picture for $100? You would. All right. We'll do that transaction after church, okay? Perfect. What about you? Would you buy my picture for $100?
No.
That's probably the more realistic answer, right? Some collections, they are sentimental, more sentimental than valuable. While other collections can be pretty valuable. As we heard, money behind me, right? Maybe I knew somebody once who had a watch collection. You think that'd be worth a good amount of money? Probably, right? What about art? I know some people who collect art. That's probably worth a lot of money too, right? Maybe stuffed animals. Are stuffed animals worth a lot of money?
Sometimes.
Yeah, what about pops? Pops?
Like Funko Pops?
Like Funko Pops. Oh. Yeah, Reese is looking at me with like I've got two heads. Reese, you should know what a pop is, right? Oh, Funko, my bad. Right? Sometimes those are worth a lot of money or not a lot of money, right? Well, the last Bible verse that Pastor Mike read for us was all about storing up treasures, right? And collections can be like treasures. But we're warned that we shouldn't put our whole heart, our whole soul, our whole mind into these collections because they're not going to be worth anything in heaven, right? This picture that Cooper has, it's not very good quality, right? It's kind of bending. It has pinholes in it. It could be destroyed real easily, right? The same as stuffed animals. Those won't last forever, okay? Watches, jewelry, paintings, none of that stuff, even money, none of that stuff is going to last us forever. And we're encouraged to store up treasures in heaven. And I think those treasures in heaven are going to look quite a bit different than our treasures here on earth. And so this week, my challenge to you is, what kind of treasures can you store up in heaven? Or how can we store up treasures in heaven? Maybe we do that by reading our Bible, praying, working on our relationship with God. So let's pray. And then we're going to go down to Sunday school, all right? All right. Dear God,
thank you so much
for the gifts.
You give us here
on earth. Help us to remember to store up our treasures in heaven. Amen.
I don't know if you've ever seen a street preacher downtown. Happens sometimes. Some cities even have a speaker's corner where preachers can stand, or anyone for that matter, and deliver a message to the public. I remember once I was at a downtown service like that, and there was someone preaching, but there was somebody walking around who had a sandwich board, and on the front it said, "The end," and they had to look at the back, "is near. The end is near." He was predicting the end of the world was near. Now that was 25 years ago. But you know what? He's still right. The end is near. He might have been just on the early side of it. What we never want to be is on the late side of that message, when it is too late. Now, I saw a cartoon, did a little spoof on that. It was a housewife in her home, and there were four kids, and two were jumping on the couch, and one was wrestling with the dog, and there's mess everywhere. And she had a sandwich board on for when her husband came home, I presume. And on the front it said, "The end is near." And on the back, "I hope." Maybe you feel that way. Our world is getting crazier by the day. The good news is the end is near. We hope. And our hope is never in vain when it's placed in God. Now, the passage we read earlier, Hebrews 10, that Pat read for us, has a very urgent statement at the end of verse 25. It says, "Let us do these things even more as we see the day approaching." And "day" in most of our Bibles is capitalized, capital D-A-Y. What is that day that's approaching? Our Pew Bible made it clear. It says the day of the Lord is approaching. The day of the Lord is when Jesus returns to punish the wicked and to reward and to bless his children. It's that day we prayed for in the Lord's Prayer. "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." So there's coming a day soon, and very soon, where we're going to see the King. And he's bringing God's kingdom from heaven to earth. He says a new heaven and a new earth will be created for us to enjoy. So that's great news for believers. But for unbelievers, the Bible says it's going to be hell on earth. I hear a lot of unbelievers talking about this day recently. Now, they don't call it the day of the Lord. They have other terms for it, like Armageddon and the zombie apocalypse. And some use an acronym, SHTF, when something hits the fan. They all are aware there's coming a cataclysmic moment that we need to prepare for. And that's the urgency here in Hebrews 10. As we see that day approaching or getting nearer, we need to prepare for it even more, says this pastor. And he gives us five ways to prepare. And as you see on the cover, they each start with the two words, "let us." And so there's your groaner. We've got pictures of lettuce on the cover. Let's look at the first one, verse 22. Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith. Let us draw near to God. Nobody will be able to stand on that day unless they have a personal relationship with God through Jesus. So now's the time to draw near to him, to be, as it says, having our heart assured in faith, a sincere heart in full assurance of faith. Now, I can just imagine when this Jewish audience first heard that message 1960 years ago. They would have heard, "Let us draw near to God," and thought, "How? What do you mean, draw near to God?" Because for thousands of years, their religion taught them God is a distant, powerful, holy being. No one can approach God. In fact, Exodus 33 says no one can even see God and live. And so when God wanted to give his people the Ten Commandments, he said, "I'll come to the top of Mount Sinai, and one of you, Moses, you can come up the mountain and receive the Ten Commandments from me, but all the rest of you, stay away. Keep your distance." He says, "Don't even touch the mountain, for it's too holy for you." Then when they built the temple, they designed it in such a way that God was in the most holy place back there in a secret room, walled off with this huge curtain that was 60 feet high, 30 feet wide, 5 inches thick, so no one could even accidentally see God. Of course, the high priest was allowed, but only once a year. Everything in the Jewish religion said, stay away from God. Keep your distance because he's too holy for you. So now how can this pastor say to them, let us draw near to God? Well, the answer is what we heard back in verse 19. We can boldly enter the most holy place because of Jesus' blood. By his death, Jesus opened a new life-giving way through the curtain into God's presence. Now, since Jesus is our great high priest, let us draw near to God. See, Jesus changed everything. His death and resurrection opened the door, so we can now know God personally. So we can worship him, well, closer than we could ever be to anyone. Jesus is that door through which we can draw near to God. Now, the one requirement, we cannot draw near to God unless verse 22 is true in our lives. That our hearts have a full assurance of faith, our hearts have been sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and our bodies have been washed with pure water. What this is saying is, only a baptized believer in Jesus can come this close to God. Because only Jesus, the Son, can come that close to God. And so when we're in him by faith, we have full access to the Father any day of the week, any hour of the day. We don't have to wait for a church like this to be opened. Driving your car, you can draw near to God with just a prayer. Let's do that if we're ever going to be ready and spiritually strong for the end of the of all days, really. Here's the second let us. Okay, the first, let us draw near to God. Now, verse 23, let us hold firmly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. The hope we profess, it's not an idea, it's not a theory. No, hope is a person named Jesus. And so let's draw near to God in worship, in prayer, and let's hold on firmly or tightly to Jesus, it says. Now, these Jewish believers needed that encouragement because many of them were letting go of Jesus. They're saying, maybe we should go back to just being Jews. Maybe we should reconvert or deconvert. Because we didn't know it was going to be this hard to follow Jesus. They took away my job. I've been blacklisted. I can't work anywhere in town. We're running out of money. They've jailed my son. They've beaten my cousin. They've killed my grandpa. Persecution was everywhere just for saying you follow Jesus. So naturally, what do you do to protect yourself? You say, like Peter, I don't know that guy. Never met him. What are you talking about, Jesus? They'd stopped going to church. They'd stopped professing their faith. They'd stopped holding on to Jesus because it was costing them. I understand that. But I love this picture. Let us hold firmly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Saw a little picture of this in a movie. A guy had gotten so depressed, he had climbed out of his 10th floor apartment window onto the ledge. He was going to jump, suicide. People called after they saw him, they called the police, an officer came, got into the apartment and tried to talk him back in. And after, it was like an hour of negotiation, finally the guy said, okay, I'll come back in. But as he turned to go back into the window, he slipped and he lost his balance and his legs fell beneath the ledge and all he could do was grab onto the windowsill for dear life. And the police officer saw this and grabbed him by the arms and said, I got you, I got you. And he said, now let go of the windowsill and put your hands on my forearm, on my arms. Let's lock. And the guy was scared to. But he did, and the officer with his strength was able to pull him into safety. We're to hold on to the one who's holding on to us, the one who's faithful, the one who is saving us. Don't let go of him because he's your life. He's all you have. Without Jesus, you won't stand on the day of judgment. So let's draw near to God in worship. Let's hold on firmly to the hope we profess. Thirdly, verse 24. Let's consider how we can encourage one another. Encourage one another toward love and good deeds. There's a word here, spur. What do you think of when you hear the word spur?
Something sharp.
Sharp? We don't watch too many Western movies these days with cowboys, do we? But they all had spurs. Why? To prod the horse, to get it going, to move it. Now, I've touched those spurs, and I've asked those who use them, can this hurt the horse? And they say, yeah, like this could hurt you, and he just did a little pinch on my arm. It's not to hurt the horse, it's to motivate it, to get it going, to say, come on, we're going forward, ready? And so verse 24 says, we're to think about who in our fellowship could use a bit of a spur. A bit of a, come on, let's go forward together.
because they've settled down, or they've stopped, or they've retreated, or they're hiding behind closed doors for fear of, well, there's a lot to be afraid of. How can we spur others to get back into action? I heard one youth pastor, his name's Dan Speeder. He was in Chicago. And he said their youth group made this their verse of the year. They always pick one verse and said, this is our motto, this is our focus, let's try and obey it all year. Hebrews 10:24, let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. And he asked the youth, how could we make this practical? And one kid said, how about we have a list of all the people in our youth group, and we just go down in order. So like Jake would call Sarah's house, and when they answer, he'll just say one word, spur. And that'll remind her to now go do something good, do something loving, either for your family, a neighbor, someone at school, whatever. Spur, that's your moment to act. And after Sarah's done that, she's to call the next person on the list and spur. And then that puts them to action. He said, we did that for a year. And our little youth group of 18 kids grew to 125 in a year. He said, we only had about 300 adults worshiping at the time. But their parents started to come. And within 5 years, that youth group in Chicago had 500 teens attending. It became a worldwide ministry called Sun Life Ministries, which is how I heard about it up here in Canada. Because they said, we're going to now help thousands of churches around the world to do Hebrews 10:24. Think of someone in your church family who could use a little encouragement or spur toward love and good deeds. And let's do it. All right, the last two lettuces or lettuci, whatever they are. Verse 25 says, let us not give up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing. Let us quit staying home. Well, you don't need to hear that. You're here. And those watching at home, I bet quite a few of them have a good reason they're staying home. Age, health, lack of transportation, whatever. No, this was written to a group who had just become so discouraged, so depressed, they said, we might as well not even have church. At a meeting not too long ago, I was talking with some fellow pastors, and we're talking about how have we recovered post-lockdown. And they shared pretty much all the same stats as I've observed here. When churches could legally open, about a third of people returned, 30 to 33%. Almost a year after being allowed to reopen, attendance has gone up to 55 to 60% of where it was. And the one pastor said, we've been very pleased because we have about 70% of our people who've returned. So that tells you there's still a gap. There's still people who could be in church worshiping, but for various reasons are not. And I think I know two of those reasons. First of all, it's easier, isn't it? Remember just getting out of bed and putting your coffee on, and who cares if it's noon or 3 p.m., let's turn the service on for a while. It's easier at home. And the second reason is, it's safer at home. There's a risk to going out and being together in a pew. So we understand the risk. We understand how easy it would be not to meet. But we hear the urgency of this pastor. Let's stop staying home. Let's get out of that habit. I'm sure you found it once you missed church for 3, 4, 7, 10 weeks. It's actually harder to get back to it. It's a new habit we formed. But for our encouragement, for our strengthening, there's a blessing when we meet together, especially around the Lord's table. He's promised to meet with us with grace. Last let us is the end of verse 25. Let's encourage each other even more as we see the day approaching. Let's encourage each other even more. Could anybody here use some encouragement in your life? If you'd be so bold and brave as to admit it, would you raise your hand with me if you could stand some encouragement? Now, that would be the majority. Some of you are on cloud nine. You're doing great. Good. Thank God. But I think the rest of us come to church and we say, it's been a hard week. I could really use somebody just with a tap on the shoulder or arm around or a smile to say, it's really good to see you today. God bless you. I am praying for you, you know. We all need that encouragement, especially as the days get harder. Saw a documentary on wolves, how they hunt. Fascinating. You know what they won't do? They won't attack a healthy herd. They won't try and get themselves in the middle of that deer or elk herd. There's too many. So what do the wolves do? They wait for a straggler, someone who can't keep up with the herd, too young, too old, too crippled, and that's the one they pick off because that person is defenseless, that animal is defenseless. And we have an enemy who would love to pick off everyone here and every one of you at home, to wipe you out spiritually so you have no faith. There's protection in the herd. There's safety when we come together in Jesus' name. So the day of the Lord, it's near. It's coming. And if we're going to be prepared for it, what must we do? Draw near to God in worship. Hold on to Jesus firmly. Think about who we can spur on and encourage with, you know, to love and good deeds. Stop staying home and start coming together so we can build the body strong. Let's pray for God's help as we make this our intention. Father, we know the Spirit is willing, but our flesh is weak. Every good intention we set out to accomplish, we usually don't get there. So, Father, give us the power of your Spirit. As we often pray in the Farringdon Prayer, give us the determination to be like our Savior in the way we live, the way we love, and the way we serve one another. We ask in Jesus' mighty name for his glory. Amen. To prepare our hearts for communion, we'll sing, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. Sing it twice. 472, if you want to follow the melody. Thank you.
And if you're able, stand with me.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory.
We state what we believe using the Apostles' Creed. In unison we say, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Let's prepare the cups now. If you take the top layer off the film, you'll find the bread wafer. And then below that, the purple tab. I always say, hold that away from your clothes when you pull open that tab, just in case. And if you got one that is sealed too tightly, you can't get it open, just go back and that will give you a new one, okay? We sometimes get tricky ones. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, I invite all who have placed their faith in him unto salvation, and who are seeking to walk in his ways by loving your neighbor, to now come to this his table. It's a table to remember his death and his resurrection. Come gratefully that Jesus has paid the price for all your sins. Come humbly, confessing that you are a sinner in need of his mercy. Let's bow in prayer. It is our constant duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, most holy Lord, our heavenly Father, who is the everlasting God. You created the heavens and earth and all that are in them. You created us in your own image. And your tender mercies are over all your works. Therefore, with the angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we worship and adore your glorious name, Lord. we evermore will praise you as we sing together. As the Lord Jesus did on the night in which he was betrayed, he took these common elements of bread and wine. I take these same common elements to now be set apart unto his holy use and mystery. On that night when Jesus was betrayed at the meal, he took bread. He gave thanks to his Father, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then after supper, Jesus took the cup, and he told them, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. As oft as you shall drink from it, do so in remembrance of me." May the Lord preserve each of his children, as he's promised to, unto everlasting life. Amen. The offering plate is at each door. Thank you for the gift that you're able to bring. Just going to pray before Derek plays the offertory. Father, thank you for meeting all of our needs and blessing us far beyond that. Help us to be as generous as you are and to give what we can when we can. I pray for the offering that you will see to it that it is used wisely to meet many people's needs in the weeks to come, including our missionaries. We ask you to strengthen them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Derek. Final hymn is 748. After you hear the introduction, please stand to sing it, verses 1 and 2. Let's rise and sing.
Lord, dismiss us with your blessing. Fill our hearts with joy and peace. Let us each your love possessing, triumph in us and protect us traveling through this wilderness. Thanks we give and adoration for your gospel's joyful sound. May the fruits of your salvation in our hearts and lives abound. Ever faithful, ever faithful to your truth may we be found.
We have refreshments to enjoy in the narthex. I hope you'll stay for a few moments. Also, bring your little used cup back there to the garbage, please. That way Annette doesn't have to pick all yours up. And in this new week, we go with the love of God our Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the power and comfort of His Holy Spirit. Amen.
Go.